energy.
We're watching.
Well, Taiwan.
This is Andrew.
This is Patty.
How are you guys?
Welcome back. Oh, wild of the day. Here it
wild
comes.
Wild of the day. Hi.
Thank you. Rain boots.
Rain boots. What's so special about these rain boots?
I don't know.
What's inside?
They're empty. I'm not smelling that. You
smell
that. I know you.
I know you. Rain boots. Does this belong to anyone here?
Those are mine.
These are yours.
These are yours.
Why are your rain boots up here?
I use those to climb mountains here in Taiwan.
You climb with these?
Yeah, you'd be surprised how many people do that, actually.
Really?
It's quite popular.
No, not for me.
You guys don't do this?
No, not for me.
No. Do you know New Zealanders, they wear, we call them gum boots.
Gum boots, right.
Wear them doing everything. They play rugby, they mow the lawn, yeah, they climb mountains as well. So, hey, this is pretty similar.
I think they call them wellies in England.
Wellies, right.
Or Wellingtons.
Yeah.
Wellies, gum boots, rain boots.
Yeah, so I thought you're supposed to wear some decent mountain climbing shoes, gear for this, but why do you choose this?
I would say because of the weather conditions in Taiwan.
Yeah?
Yes, normally you would wear traditional hiking boots, but Taiwan's a very wet, humid place.
Yes.
And
exactly.
There's really nothing more waterproof than those.
Okay.
And if you have ever hiked in Taiwan, you've probably hiked in wet boots before. And when your socks and shoes get wet, it's so humid they never dry out.
Right.
And then you're going to be getting blisters and your feet are going to hurt.
Trench foot.
I heard in Japan they wear rain boots as well.
It's colder and there's more snow up there, so these probably aren't as suitable in Japan.
Oh,
it's a lot drier.
More slippery and stuff?
They're not very good in snow, and they have a lot more snow.
Okay. You can have your boots back.
Thank you.
Well, let's watch the VCR to get a bit more information on mountain climbing in Taiwan.
Taiwan is an island filled with mountains. 70% of the island is covered with mountain ranges and hills. Even 3 out of the 6 Taiwanese national parks are located at higher elevations. As more and more people have taken up hiking, a hiking culture unique to Taiwan gradually developed. For example, hiking in rain boots. A simple pair of rain boots contain the wisdom of Taiwanese people. Your rain boots don't have shock absorption function like hiking boots do? Add a few layers of shoe pads. Your rain boots lack the ankle protection that hiking boots provide? Easy. Add a pair of ankle guards and problem solved. Taiwanese hikers utilized their wisdom, turning a less than $10 pair of rain boots into a pair of hiking boots worth at least $100. Now let's take a look at what other interesting things these hikers would encounter in the mountains of Taiwan.
Mountain climbing.
Yeah, mountaineering, right?
In Taiwan, and I heard for a lot of foreigners, it's a very magical thing.
Yeah.
It's so easy to get to, right? William?
Well, actually, it's easy to get to in a way that travel distance is not that far.
Because we're a small island.
Yeah, it's a small island. But actually, to really get into the center of the mountain is not so easy. Yeah, because actually comparing to, for example, most of the mountain in Europe, let's say, it's already well developed for centuries.
Right.
But in Taiwan, actually, you can imagine there's actually lots of region which has zero people visiting and no one actually lived there. And then there's
still undiscovered.
Y. Exactly. There are bears, there are deers or whatever animals.
True wilderness.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's something that all these foreigners, they are very surprised about.
Yes. Because,
for example, like a few years ago, before the pandemic, I have a chance to brought friends of mine from Austria to visit in Taiwan. Mm-hmm. And they're actually surprised about the vegetation, the forest in Taiwan.
Yes.
Because first we have like such a high mountain, and then we are so close to the ocean.
Yes.
Yeah, so actually you can actually see that if you are starting from somewhere like 500 meters to 3000, you're actually moving from tropic to temper, and then eventually ends up like somewhere looks like polar.
That's something very cool. Yes, so true.
Well, do you have that kind of views in Malaysia as
well? No.
Not at all?
No, not at all.
What were some special kind of scenes or features that really jumped out to you when you were climbing on these, like, these trips?
Like deers.
Okay.
Samba deers.
In Samba deers?
Yes.
That scared me. Okay, I was not expecting
that. That's from a deer?
Yes.
Not from any birds? Wow, how sweet.
It sounded so much smaller.
Yeah.
Like a gopher, you know?
Yeah, but it's actually so handsome.
Yeah, majestic.
Majestic.
Yeah.
You've seen this.
Yes, and it's a very special experience because it was the first day of the Lunar New Year in this year.
Okay.
And that day we were at the Lulu Valley cabin. Yeah, Lulu Valley cabin is a cabin on the south section two of the Central Mountain Range. And at that time I was relieving myself near to the cabin. And then suddenly a large deer appeared out of nowhere and it started screaming at me and charged towards me.
Can I listen to that again?
Yeah, I'd run. Yeah.
Yes.
But it sounds so weak.
Yeah, it sounds really cute.
It sounds like, eep!
But it's actually very loud.
Mm.
And the deer is really large. It is larger than a motorcycle.
Yeah.
So I was very scared at that time.
You've seen as well?
Many times.
Many times.
Oh, look, there it is.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, he's so cute.
Yeah.
But you were pretty overwhelmed.
I was very scared and I ran away.
Why was it charging you?
Yeah, it charged at me because I was relieving myself and it ate out my poop.
Really?
Yeah. After chasing me away, then it ate out my poop.
She said relieving. I thought she was like
relaxing.
Yeah, but no, she was taking a poop.
She was, you know, nature's call in nature.
Right. What was the reason that it wanted to approach you? Is it because you had something it needed?
Taiwanese hikers always say that they are quite lack of mineral salt.
Yeah.
They need salt in their diet and there is none out there. So they get it from humans either through the food that we throw away or other things.
Wow. Okay.
So they know where people camp and they will just hang out and wait for groups of hikers to come through. And they're not afraid of people. They will walk right up to your tent and wait for you to
It's like,
up.
Hey man, you gotta go yet?
I can wait.
It's just like...
Yeah, that's actually quite right.
That's totally accurate.
Hey, it's 5 a.m., let's go!
And then they will fight
Take a leak.
They will fight with each other over it too.
Really?
So you'll see like big group, like depending on where you go, like certain routes have places where there's like 30, 40, 50 deer.
Wow.
No way.
Like, yeah.
A mob.
Like, there's like a gang.
Yeah, literally like a mob. Because
there
are lots of accidents happen that they run into the tent while people is not there and then open their backpack and eat all the stuff.
Go for the food.
Wow, but as a mountain amateur.
So is this something that you would bring with you?
Yes, I bring it up to every mountain.
the flag of Malaysia?
Yes, the flag of Malaysia.
Are you out here like claiming territory for Malaysia?
Hey, what pose do you do? What pose do you do for
Can you give us a
when
pose?
You reach?
Like when you reach the
summit?
And
I use a drone to take photos.
Okay.
Oh, and this is actually your
hiking pole.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Yeah. Then you'll no need to bring a flex pole again.
Okay, so you're really trying to be like as efficient as possible with all the things you bring up there.
Yes.
That makes sense.
Well,
thank you so much.
Cute.
That's a nice flag.
And it gives me connection with my homeland because I haven't been home yet when I started to climb mountains because of COVID.
So this is a pretty new experience for you, climbing.
Yeah. After the COVID outbreak.
Okay. Yeah. Well, what do you bring up there?
I have some of those, some I collected from each mountain.
Oh, these are your souvenirs?
Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, they're beautiful.
Yeah, and it makes me feel like I'm very touching, watching them every time because it moves around maybe very, 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 very north part of the globe, and then it comes to Taiwan, and it's very fantastic.
Yeah.
So you collect them when you go hiking, mountaineering.
Yeah, but I don't collect too much.
Right.
Because I need to keep them for the animals.
Exactly. Yeah. What about you, David? Do you have any fun souvenirs or?
Just this flag that I brought to my
family. Also flag.
Oh, that's also flag.
Yes. Where are you from?
I'm from Poland.
Okay.
Also claiming territories.
Can you show us? Can you show us
sure.
your flag?
Unwrap this.
That's a beautiful flag.
The other way around.
Okay.
Oh, no, the other way. Oh, wait,
otherwise, it's Indonesia. Wow, that's awesome. So everybody is, you know, still missing their hometown mm-hmm. when they're in Taiwan, enjoying the scenery and yeah. everything.
This is an interesting sight.
A lot of tents.
But there's a tarp there?
It looks like a...
Is that a lean-to?
It's basically a lean-to. That was on a trip that William and I did together. Yes, that's a tarp. Recently, I've been using those instead of a tent just because they're lighter.
But isn't that colder?
Not really. I mean, I suppose it could be, but you save the weight on your tent so you can bring more clothes. And, like, you have more of a nice romantic experience.
Wow. You even have space for those lights.
I wouldn't do it in the winter when it's real cold, but it's much more, you get more in touch with nature this way, I would say. You're not just like in a little box.
Also, when you set up this tarp, you just need to make sure that you block the wind.
Right.
You
know?
Yeah. So usually there's a direction the wind is keep blowing, and then you block this, and it's actually quite comfortable inside.
And you can fit like three or four people under one.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, like, you know, carrying a three or four person tent is a lot heavier.
You know, people say when you hike together, it's quite romantic. Look at them.
I know, seriously. It's like,
beautiful.
This is a long and lasting relationship.
I know. Yeah. They have the same hobbies. They share stars. Stargazing. Like, oh.
Most people just share their life. They share stars.
Baby. Oh, I think it's a lot of fun hiking together with your buddies, right?
Absolutely.
Hey, Weston, what you got?
Okay.
Wow.
Did you order Uber Eats or something?
No, it's kind of hard to get Uber Eats or Food Panda delivered up in the mountains.
Tell us about your feasts. What are these?
You know,
I
would say that food is one of the most important parts of hiking, not only for nutrition, but just as a morale booster.
Is this ramen?
Yeah, sure.
This is crazy. You have this on the mountains?
Tasa.
Sure, sure.
You even have tasa and you have steak.
Sure. Why not?
So wait, how did you bring this? How do you carry all this?
Yeah,
stuff?
You carry everything.
Because he has a lightweight.
Oh, that's right. He doesn't have a tent. He can pick up for the weight.
Exactly. Now you're starting to get it.
Right. I want to hike with you now.
Pros and cons. I get this.
Yes.
Yeah. You can make almost any. It depends on how long you're hiking, but you can make almost anything in the mountains.
I thought people only put hot water in these, you know, space food.
If you want to, you know, have
that's
boring.
That's what I do.
Yeah.
That's what you do. Okay, so.
I'm not as strong as Daniel. So I carry those lightweight food, like you said, like you mentioned. Did you see the bag over there?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, these ones.
Yeah.
Assorted vegetable rice with
something
cheese.
Something like that. And you just put water in.
They're warm. Let's have them.
Yo, this is pretty nice. This smells good.
Yeah, totally.
Let's test it really quick.
And
you know, I heard they're pretty good.
Yeah. There's actually a lot of different brands, especially the Japanese made really good food.
I know.
Yeah, but this is from Taiwan, but it is also okay.
It's not that bad.
And one of the reasons that I choose that.
Oh, it's not that bad.
It's good.
I know.
I'm sorry, what's the reason?
Because after you finish it, it can be your bowl, your lightweight bowl.
For going to his place for lunch. Yeah, I would like that.
Sorry, that was really funny. I wanted to know, like, because I mean, another thing to do is just bring fruit, right? Because that's pretty easy and it's biodegradable for the most part, right?
You shouldn't do that.
Really? You shouldn't?
The higher up in elevation you get, the longer it takes for something to biodegrade. Like, there was a foreigner who got in trouble for throwing a banana peel, like, in the mountains.
You get a fine?
I don't remember if he got a fine or not, but he got in trouble, like, because they said, like, yeah, it's biodegradable, but, you know, you're also encouraging animals to, like, go where people are going.
That's true.
You know, so even though you probably could throw an orange peel or a banana peel, you really should just take it down.
He's so chill, like, laid
that
back right
tea.
Now.
Yeah, the cup of tea. And the blazer.
Oh, yeah, tea is good. Like, yeah, the thing about drinking tea in the mountains is, like, you know, in the city, I don't particularly like tea, but when you're up in the mountains, it's much more of a social activity.
Uh-huh.
Like, when you get to camp at the end of the day, usually the first thing, like, one of the Taiwanese hikers will be like, oh, you want a cup of tea? And like you just say yes, and then they talk about their day or their experiences. Yeah. And
I mean, you had the same day, you hiked the same mountain.
Yeah. Well, like,
but, probably you guys can try to imagine that is a place where it has no Wi-Fi. Okay.
So you really
so once you arrive there, you literally do nothing else.
It's good.
Yeah. So you have to find something which is easy, and then you can chillax with peoples.
Cultural.
So making a tea or coffee, that's
it's also a cultural exchange kind of thing.
Yeah. Actually, tea bag has quite an advantage. So tea bag after you use that, it can serve as a soap.
Because it can cut the grease.
Yes. Right. Yes. It cuts the grease. And then, for example, like after a heavy meal here, you have to clean up.
Right.
And then if you just have water, you never clean up. So most of the time what we do is like if you have a tea bag and then you just wipe it around.
Okay.
And then it will be easier to clean up all the grease and fat and so on.
So it's also about like reducing the amount of things you bring up in the first place.
Yes.
And keeping it low and recycling and reusing a lot of the stuff. Like,
How high are the mountains? What's your number of 3,000?
3,000ers. Oh, so this is like a big number.
Mountains like, over 3,000 meters. So guess how many?
How many
Andrew?
In Taiwan? 百岳 嘛, 100 peaks, right?
百岳不一定.
My guess. I'll go the conservative 100.
100.
I know they're a bit more, but that's my conservative
guess. You guys all know, right?
You know the answer.
So what's the correct answer?
What's the correct answer? Let's find out. 285!
What?
That's a lot, really?
185. But William, you study the mountains. You're
a
assistant professor in Taiwan University, right?
Yeah, sure.
So, wow, it's quite fascinating, the number.
Actually, if you imagine like the size of Taiwan, actually only one-third of the lands are occupied by people, and then two-thirds are basically mountains. Actually, the density of the 3,000ers in Taiwan is actually the highest density among the world.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Is that up there?
You can't find any other island has such, or any territory has such high density of mountains.
Wow. Yeah. And you mean in the area that we're in?
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. Well, that's a lot to process in 1 minute. I think I need a breather just to kind of recuperate the reality of the mountains that we have.
Hey, you're in the city.
I know, and I like it.
So you're out there already.
But yeah, now I'm getting pulled up to their elevation.
All right, so let's give Andrew a break. We'll be back very soon.
You probably heard about Taihuanshan, but they're really easy to get to. You know, even Agong Ama can climb them.
What? He said,
yeah, here you go.
Ama do bi ni qiang.
This is quite
fun. Ama zhen de hen qiang a. Hold on. Welcome back. Sorry.
Wow, Taiwan. Alex, did you caught your breath yet?
I did. I'm still kind of buffering, but I'll be there in a second. Why don't you take over for a minute?
Okay. We were just talking about how we're going to arrange our mountain climbing schedule. Maybe we'll start from Xiangshan.
Is that one of them? That doesn't count, right?
It's not even a mountain.
That's a hill.
Hey, if I want to start, where do I start?
So you don't really have to go to anything that difficult. You don't have to walk.
I don't have to go for like aiming big mountains.
I don't have to start
with
Jade
Mountain. It's just very easy to get to, and it's very easy to climb. You probably heard about Taihuanshan.
Oh,
it's the place where everyone goes to see the snow in winter.
Right.
And everyone gets stuck and their cars just jam up
always for snow in Taiwanshan,
exactly.
Right?
Okay. So there's actually four or five peaks around there that are really easy to get to. You know, even Agong Ama can climb them really easily. Yeah.
Really?
One of them actually just goes along the road.
Yep,
here you go.
Oh, Ama do bi ni qiang.
This is quite
fun. Ama zhen de hen qiang a. Hold on.
I feel so weak.
Yeah, I know.
Is this serious? By walking slowly in good weather, it's accessible.
So it's because it's like a well-traveled one that is paved and very well-maintained.
It's this kind of gravel that you see over there.
But most
importantly, the road goes right next to the entrance. So you can just drive there and then walk a little bit. There you are.
Hey, hold up. That counts.
That counts, yes.
But it's a good way to get introduced into the culture and the idea of the Baiyue.
Yeah, I mean, you can see some of like the bamboo right here, which you'll see on some of the harder mountains behind it.
Oh, but the view is amazing.
If you're lucky.
Good weather, good luck.
Yeah. But yes, there are a lot of grandparents who hike. A lot of retired people take up mountaineering when they are retired. And so you see them, sometimes they're doing it like this, and sometimes they're in big commercial groups of 20, 30, 40 people.
My first Baiyue is Hehuan East Peak.
Okay.
How many days?
About half an hour.
So you're the one who drove to 3,000 and yeah. then walked up and took a picture.
Yeah. Actually, I was traveling with my friends that day and we were on motorbikes.
You yeah. scootered up there.
Yeah.
what weather?
Oh, that weather. Yeah.
It's misty, but it's not rain. Yeah.
So that's why you need a lock.
You need luck.
Usually we call this a white wall.
A white wall.
If you hit a white wall, that will be like this.
When you're climbing mountains, you always get white walls like in the early afternoon. So for me, I always try to like start early, finish early.
Oh, what's this?
What does this mean? Daniel 100, David 100, William 74, Sasa 48, Pampa 21. What does this stand for?
Age. I'm kidding. That was a low blow.
Test scores.
Test scores.
Test scores. David, can you answer for us?
Yeah, that's the number of top 100 that we all finished.
Wow.
So you finished everyone.
Yes.
Whoa.
Wow.
It took me a while. It took me 8 years to finish.
Eight years. But you were taking your time.
Yeah, I wasn't rushing, yes.
Okay.
So in Mandarin, we call it Bai Yue.
Yeah.
Is 100 peaks. And does it have a, if I am a mountaineer or I'm an amateur, do I have to conquer all these 100 mountains to, you know, really tell the world I can hike?
Well, that's a usually when we're doing hiking, we probably don't use conquer. Because this word is actually a little bit too aggressive for approaching mountain. Because actually, when you're doing hiking, you really experience that the nature has like way much great power than any single person can handle.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
So that's actually something that makes us try to be humble.
Right.
So that we'll probably try not to use this word. But approaching the mountain is probably a way. And then when you mentioned about the 100 peaks, there's a hiking club here before, and then they start to set a goal about what will be a 100 peaks. So it has to fit three criteria. Yep. First, you have to about 3,000 meters.
Okay.
And it has to have a triangular measuring point.
Okay. Triangular measuring point. So it has to have a point that you can actually.
It has to have a point, exactly. Okay. And then the third one should be like, this mountain is supposed to have a very distinguished looking.
It has to have a really unique feature.
Yes.
Well, it's,
yes.
you know, cultural significance, height, beauty, danger, yeah. risk. There has to be a good reason to include it on the list.
Like yeah, exactly.
Yeah, there has to be like a reason.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, some people spend their whole lives trying to do the 100 peaks. You know, some people never get to do it. I believe the actual record, the fastest anyone has ever done it, is something like 83 or 87 days or something like that to get all 100. I finished a couple of years ago.
Wow.
Yeah, that's my sign. I got it right here, actually.
That's cool.
I got memorable.
Yeah, I got it right here.
百岳一完成,
was that the last one you?
This was the 100th one.
Wow.
This is the 100th one right there.
Oh wow.
Actually, if you look under my hat, I got that little headscarf on. I got that right here too.
Wow. Wow. It went up with you to many mountains. Right?
Yeah. So she had her flag of Malaysia, and he had his Polish flag. I don't have an actual flag, but I wear mine on my head.
There you go. That's so
cool. I got all this stuff. They put an article in the on the newspaper.
Woohoo!
Right here. Oh my! Oh, wow. Oh my god!
Wow.
Yeah, I'm not the only foreigner, obviously. David has also finished. So there's, it's a very small fraternity of us. You know how many there are?
I think it's around eight now.
Six or eight or something.
Six or eight foreigners.
Yes. Foreigners, yeah.
Okay. David, do you remember your first 100
peak? Course. So there is 100 peaks by Yue. The first one is Lushan.
Lushan, where is this? Where's Lushan?
That's very close to Lushan. That's very close to the highest peak.
This is a mountain that nobody wants to do
twice.
Yeah,
exactly.
So why? Tell me why.
There's a story here.
So that mountain is on one of the branch of the South Peak of Jade Mountain. So that South Peak of Jade Mountain is 3,800 something. Mm-hmm. So you first have to go up to 3,800 something, and then descending down to 2,981. And after finish this one, you have to climb all the way back to 3,800.
Oh my god.
And then back to the cabin, because the cabin is somewhere there. Yeah. So you have to do this in one day.
Wow.
In one day.
Yeah.
It's
so
accessible.
Descending like almost 1,000,
it's
then
like
climbing
1,000 down, 1,000 up.
And the last one is that one over there. It's Yushan Jade Mountain.
Wow.
So that was 8 years later. A little bit of beard over there.
Happy in this photo. He looks so happy.
Absolutely happy. And I was happy enough to have the people that joined me on the first peak also join me on the last peak.
Because that first photo was like, I don't know what I got myself into. This one was like, I was worth it.
Yeah, it was fun. During the first hike, it was my first experience in Taiwan, and I loved every minute of the day. It's, as you can see, it's a beautiful weather. During the day, I was like, I want to go to that mountain, I want to do all them all. Mm. And during the night, I'm like, I'm not doing this ever again. Wow. So yeah, it's ups and downs, ups and downs.
Oh, what do we have? Another little surprise.
What is this? What do you have? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Weston.
Oh, cheers.
Thank you. Hey.
It's first tip we've got all season.
What all right, does you this? Can take thank you. I was waiting. Okay, on our $1,000 note, this, we have the mountain at the back. What mountain is this?
On the 1,000?
Jade Mountain.
Jade Mountain.
Jade Mountain, Main Peak.
Main Peak.
And what about this one?
Daba. Mount Silvana.
Where? She's saying things I don't even know about.
Wow. Hey, in order to access these mountains, you all need mountain permits, right? To apply for. Yes. Is it very
easy?
Mafan?
It's a nightmare.
It is.
It's a nightmare. Tell us about it.
Okay, so there are different national parks in Taiwan, and they're like the Jade Mountain.
Yes.
Jade Mountain is in the Yushan National Park.
Yes.
And the Dabajie Mountain in the 501 is in the Shepa National Park. So in different national parks, they have different methods to get the entry permits.
Mm. But don't I just go online and...
Yeah, it's in the same website, but different method when they like... In for the Yushan National Park, you have to participate in a lucky draw.
Oh, it's a lottery.
Right. Yes.
Yes.
And for Shepa National Park, it is like snatching tickets for a concert. You have to snatch the entry permit.
So they'll tell you what time they'll have how many available.
Yes.
So how many in one lot?
It is different in every trail. For every trail, it's different. There are different places.
The snatching concert tickets is a really good metaphor. You have to like know, like, I want to go on this day, and then you have to go, okay, well, if I want to enter on like April 1st, then I need to go 2 months back to February 1st, 7 a.m., this is like when the permit system opens, and you need to like already have your permit saved as a draft on their website, and then at 6:55, you got to wake up, go on their website, at 7 o'clock, submit it, and then you might snatch it.
You literally do like this.
Yeah, you literally, it's like buying Gautier tickets. You know? And if you wait until 7:05, they're all gonna be gone.
I've actually heard a fun story from one of my friends. They joined the lottery as like, oh, it'll be fun, I won't get it, and then they got it. And they had to like cancel everything.
Oh, no.
It's like, my life is upheaved. I have to go to the mountain now. I got it, so
sorry,
I gotta go.
Yeah, you have to.
I mean, for Taiwanese, there's people who've been rejected to go to Jade Mountain like dozens of times.
Yeah,
I'm lucky.
Yeah, but for foreigners, we're a little bit more lucky because
place.
Yeah,
that there because
it's the most
but not
popular
for
mountain,
every day, yeah.
And so the cabin, the main cabin that everybody sleeps in, on weekdays they set aside bunks only for foreigners.
Why?
So like we're kind of spoiled that way.
So there's a little life hack there, like if
only for us.
Yeah.
But you need to change the language of the website
before that shows up.
Yeah. You can't access it from a Chinese website.
You heard it here, folks, guys. You heard
now
it here
you
first.
Know, that's a trick. But these permits are actually to keep people safe or to keep count of the, what is it for?
Well, if there's thousands of people applying for Jade, you obviously can't fit them all in the park. So in this particular case, yeah, it's just the cabin has limited space, the campsites have limited space.
Okay.
But also for some mountains, yes, you need to prove that, you've done something similar before.
Right.
Oh. They're more difficult.
So you have to submit like a resume.
Kind of, yeah, you have to write a document outlining what you did.
And also to protect the nature, right?
Yes.
Don't let that much people
exactly.
in.
Exactly, that's also the other reason for the eco capacity.
Right. Yes.
So they don't want to have so many people enter that region because you definitely make some change there.
Right? Wow.
Absolute lifesaver pieces of gear or equipment that you have to bring with you.
Maps like these.
Oh,
I mean,
these are adorable.
This is like a grass knife. It's curved.
Oh, yeah.
Like a sickle.
I think I see pineapple ape.
Yeah.
Uses this as well.
What would be some like absolute lifesaver pieces of gear or equipment that you have to bring with you on one of these camping, like hikes?
I have two with me here.
Yeah?
This one's actually Daniel's, this one's
this
mine.
This is very important.
Is that a GPS?
This is a satellite messenger.
Oh, okay.
So it allows you to communicate with people without cell phone signal.
Yes.
Because very often in Taiwan, in the mountains, there's just no cell phone signal.
Right. Yep.
You have to get up on a peak. And it still depends, because sometimes if it's cloudy, like, there's still absolute
no
signal. I mean, and this one here is a PLB, it's a personal locator beacon. So this one is only in case of emergency, and what this does is you press a button. Actually, this one also has an SOS button.
Okay.
And it just sends a signal with your location, you know, in case you fall down, break a leg, there's okay. no one else.
Or if you're lost, just stay put, don't move, hit the button.
Yes.
Make
yes.
sure you have shelter and water. And
yes, because there are dangerous situations in the mountains that can happen. I got lost for 3-4 days in the mountains.
You have?
In like complete... downpour of rain. Oh. We couldn't find our way back. So in that particular situation, it wasn't as dangerous. I wouldn't use this. I would probably use a messenger to communicate with people outside. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But this one is for absolute emergencies.
Right.
But
it's good to have with you.
Yeah, absolutely.
You must have.
Each team. In fact, I would say each member of a team should have it, because teams, unfortunately in Taiwan, teams split sometimes.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
That's very often when people die, when people get lost and they never get found out.
Were you alone when you got lost?
No, I was with the team.
Oh, okay.
So luckily we managed to find our way out.
All right, all right.
Whether you're up in the mountains or in the sea, for us divers, we have one of those as well.
Yes.
Really?
Yeah,
open
when we
sea
get
kayakers
as yeah, well, in yeah. just in case we get carried away by
current.
Strong currents
yeah, yeah,
and stuff.
Yeah.
So we need that safety first, and always have a buddy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Garmin was in the news recently.
Oh yeah.
In Taiwan, Garmin's like the GPS messenger over there.
Yeah.
And they're improving their service, I guess, in Taiwan, and they're starting to sell these things now because. So many people are getting lost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because more and more people are
going out there.
Right, and it just seems kind of silly to not have this kind of feature or product or service in
mm-hmm.
Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
So, hey, we need sponsors.
Hey, Garmin, call us.
They all need them.
I love the stuff you got.
They're good people.
Sasa, what kind of lifesaver do you have?
Map, Sun River map.
You bring that with you?
Because yeah, there's no reception up there.
Everything,
that's a really good point. I have such a city brain.
You're a city boy.
City brain.
Yeah, they cut it into little maps like this.
Oh,
this
is cute.
These are adorable. May I?
Yeah, yes. You have to open it
up. Oh.
They also have one, I think.
Wow.
Okay.
Very useful.
I thought it was going to be like a book. I thought
no,
for some
no.
reason.
No, these are actual maps.
Oh,
yeah,
wow,
actual
wow.
maps, yeah.
Oh, it's these very are very
detailed.
Cool.
They're waterproof.
Oh, these are waterproof.
Yeah. This is waterproof as well.
They're all waterproof.
Yeah,
wow.
Waterproof. Yeah.
Just in case.
Careful, you can get a paper cut on that.
So maps is a necessity.
Okay.
Must
yes,
bring.
Yes. You have to know the trail you are taking before you go onto it, because I experienced some incident.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. On the Kalolo Cliff. Kalolo Cliff is a landscape between the Chilai peaks. This is the spot.
Wow. Are you stranded?
yeah, we're stranded there because my hiking partner fell down the cliff 3 times in a row. Yeah.
Oh my
the
goodness.
Same person?
Yeah.
Is it your
He's
problem?
No.
Every time he came up, you're like, back down, down.
You see, the hiking pole is shaved off by the cliff.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Look at that.
So this was you trying to, it was your friend trying
yeah,
to
my friend.
There was a
hold
section
to...
down here that's now
Yeah,
there.
Yeah. It's up there. You wow. can't get
Wait,
it.
It's down, up there,
it's down the
down.
Valley.
Okay. He came down with you.
Yeah, he came down.
He's safe.
There.
He's safe. Oh. Hi. Hi, friend.
Hi.
Be
job.
Safe.
Good job.
Yeah.
Careful.
Wow, yeah. This is
So this is like
scary.
your trophy, kind of. Of like surviving and remembering.
Souvenir.
Yeah, souvenir. Yeah,
souvenir from nature, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, because the landscape there is very fractured and the stones there is very fragile. So and
it's quite loose, right?
Yeah, very loose. And we didn't did enough preparation before the trip, so we calculate the time wrongly and we can't find a campground before the dark.
Oh.
Yeah, so after my hiking partner fell 3 times down the cliff, then we decide to just pitch our tent there and it was just next to the cliff. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And we survived. We survived the night.
So what suggestions would you professionals give Sasa if we meet kind of situation like this?
Well, I think she did this quite well, because actually when you feel like something went wrong and then you cannot figure it out, you should actually camp immediately
like
and then
stop.
Try to settle down.
Okay.
Also, lots of, for example, like getting lost in the mountain is due to panic.
Right.
So when you start to feel like you're panicked, then don't try to figure out anything because you won't be able to do that.
Right.
So you should try to settle down and then set up a tent because it brings you some kind of safety. And then wait a little bit, and then once you are calmed down and then realize what's going on and so on, then you move on. Mm-hmm, or you wait until the next day. So she's actually doing quite well.
And I bought this thing after that trip.
A knife.
Wait, you bought a knife because you got lost? That's not a very cool-headed reaction. Can I see this?
Yeah, this is a chopper. You can
like
chop.
Why did you want to buy this?
Oh, if I had this thing at that time, I can chop off the plants and make a better campground. So we no need to pitch our tent near to the cliff.
Wow, this is a very serious tool.
I got one too.
You got one too.
That one's a stray one. That's really good for chopping. This is like a grass knife. It's curved.
Oh, yeah. Like a sickle. Yeah.
Like a sickle. So this is more for like shaving grass.
I think I see the pineapple ape.
Yeah.
Uses this as well. Yeah, you can shave pineapple.
With either of these, you can chop firewood if you need to make a fire, or you can clear a campsite, or cut through bamboo. I mean, they both serve the same purpose.
Mm-hmm. But is it heavy?
Yes.
It's not that heavy, but it's sturdy. You can tell it's sturdy.
Mine's pretty heavy.
Whoa, yours is heavy.
Okay, I have a light version.
Oh, yeah, okay, light version is good.
Well, that's a saw.
So this is basically a saw.
Okay.
And actually, you can bend it, and then it's actually quite handful that you can just like.
Yeah, right.
And if it's grass, then these two are good enough. But if they're the bush, then it's quite difficult to cut. So this is actually a very handy saw that you can basically just like cut up most of the bush that that is on the way and so on.
Because it's really important to make a safe place for you to rest.
Exactly. And also, most of the time when you're doing non-traditional route, it's like some exploration route that you don't exactly know where to go, and then there's a bush or whatever riding in front of you, then you can use this to open the roads.
But not for beginners to suggest it.
Not for beginners, for sure. Right.
Yeah. We should start with the Hohensam where it's all paved.
Yes, the stairs.
Can you imagine showing up the Hohensam like, all right, let's do this.
Yes, I have this, I'm professional.
So a lot of people think that you need to go to a hiking store to get all the equipment that you need to climb a mountain. But actually, if you go to a general store just like this one, you can find a lot of the same things for a much lower price. Let's go inside and check it out. So one thing I always look for when I go to these general stores is gloves. People think that maybe you don't need gloves, and even if you're hiking in the summer when the weather is warm, you need gloves not necessarily to keep your hands warm, but to protect them when you're climbing on rocks and ropes and things like that. If you go to a hiking store, you're gonna spend $2,000, $4,000 NT on a pair of really expensive gloves that you don't necessarily need. So I recommend these kind of gloves. I see here they have saws, something like this. This is good for creating firewood, cutting trees. I want to point out that it's illegal to do that in a national park, so you shouldn't be cutting any tree. If you're in a national park, that's a big no-no. Don't do that. You'll get in trouble. Only if it's like an absolute emergency. As you hike more and more, you will start to notice that your body hurts. Everybody's does, especially as you get older. This is something I have direct experience with. There's different types of supports and braces for the different body parts. Most of the time I use them for my knees, something similar to this. This is called a knee brace. You've probably seen people using these before. When you're going down a mountain, your lower and upper leg bones are kind of hitting each other like this, and the cartilage in between can get bruised or ripped or torn. And this helps to stabilize your knee and make sure you don't twist your knee. They have them for, elbows and wrists and ankles. If you have a pre-existing injury in your elbow or wrist or something like that, this is definitely something you want to consider. So as you can see, buying things at the general store sometimes works out. You can get things at a much cheaper price than you could at a hiking store. So if you get the chance, I definitely recommend coming to a store just like this for some of your hiking needs.
Wow!
Any advice for beginners? How do I start?
There's so many places that there's bus stations, so you can go back home.
It'll tell you like where each campsite is every day.
Who can recognize which mountain is which?
Ah, that's easy.
He said that's easy. Okay, I'm not gonna ask you. Heard all these stories and know how you very professional mountain climbers, mountaineers. Mm-hmm. But what about us if we want to go beginners? Any advice for beginners? How do I start except for Hehuansan? Mm-hmm, any mm-hmm. other advices?
Maybe Pan? You can go to the Yangming Mountains.
Yangming no, Mountains. Are you talking about Seven Star, Qixing?
Yeah, something like that.
I've climbed that. Okay, I love that mountain.
You can climb. Okay, if you try Qixing Mountain before, maybe you can climb a little bit longer. Maybe right. you can climb from, you know, Fengguizi. Okay, yeah. Okay, there's 10 peaks in Yangming Mountain mm-hmm. from the west to the east. Mm-hmm. Usually it's a 12 hours hike mm-hmm. or 13 mm-hmm. hours hike. Right. So you can use that for preparation before going to the Baiyue.
Oh, good training, kind
yeah,
of conditioning.
It's good training. And you can see people wearing like heavy bags, like maybe 10 kilograms mm-hmm. for that, mm-hmm. for training.
Training.
Yeah, so just to get yourself more into the condition that you have to walk all day long and your
gear on your
with
back.
With gear, and your stamina, your endurance is okay. And in case, if you don't feel that good, one of the very good advantage in Yangming Mountain is that there's so many places that there's bus stations, so you can go back home. Like you feel like okay, this
That's
is not
important.
Yeah. You've had enough.
Yeah, okay, this is not your
Next
thing.
Time.
Yeah, you can just take a bus and go home. I mean, go to the land.
Well, it's a good preparation.
Right. Route. So, what would like a schedule be? What's an ideal kind of starting, like itinerary? I guess.
Well, the first thing I would say is buy that box of maps that she has right there.
Read the map.
Yeah, I think we all probably have that. So if you open up one of these maps, they actually tell you the schedule right here. Day 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Uh-huh. Right here. It'll tell you like where each campsite is every day and like what mountains you're gonna climb over. And this is the standard route that like most people would do.
So it's kind of like they give you like a targeted time when you should reach that point.
It's the route that most people of normal athletic ability and experience should shoot for.
Okay. Right.
So like for me, what I always do is I actually write my own itineraries. Mm-hmm. So like I take that 6-day itinerary and I study it and I make, like this is an example of my itineraries. You can see it.
Can I see? Wow, it's pretty detailed.
It should be. Like, I mean, it tells you like
he's down to every 20 minutes.
Are you a super organized person or only during mountain hiking?
I'd like to think I'm pretty organized, but I mean like not only do you want to know like where you're going, but you want to think about like emergency camps, water sources.
Look at that, from 9 to 9:25, and then 9:25 to 9:45. He's going in like small
so
increments.
Yeah. Do you guys do this?
Yeah, usually before you go on a hike, you will try to read other people's itinerary. And most of the people, their itineraries is that go down to 30 minutes or 1 hour. It's common because and there's so many details, like you see a big rock here and then you may turn right and then you see the there's a slope there and you have to go through it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it should be very, very detailed.
Very detailed.
As detailed as possible.
I mean time-wise, you probably feel like 20 minutes is like nothing, but imagine in the mountain, you walk 20 minutes, you
right.
only
Non-stop.
Walk.
Right.
You just walk and you do nothing else, just walk.
Right. Yeah.
So 20 minutes, if it's like a ascending, that will be a lot.
They can go on and on.
Yeah, I know.
For like 3 episodes.
But there's like an encyclopedic amount of knowledge.
Hey, but I'm really curious. Mountains for, you know, us city people.
Yeah.
They might look the same, but to you guys, everyone is so different.
Right.
So, here's we're gonna quiz you. Who can recognize which mountain is which?
Ah, that's easy.
He said that's easy. Okay, I'm not gonna ask you.
You can ask me.
All right, Pam.
Mountain Jade.
Left is Mountain
left or,
Jade?
Left or right?
Right. The right one.
The right one, Mountain Jade.
Yeah. Do you know what the left one is?
I think it looks like Hehuan.
David?
It could be snow, but I'm... No, it's not snow.
Ha ha. Hehuan.
Hehuan. So Hehuan and Jade?
Yeah.
Okay, William.
So the left one is Hehuan East Peak, and then that one is indeed Mountain Jade, but the South Peak.
Oh my God!
East Peak, Mountain Jade.
You get no prize. Next pop quiz. Let's see what we have.
Oh, wow, that's a beautiful photo. Okay, yeah, sorry, I got distracted. Anyway.
Okay.
Anyone?
Zhongyanjian.
On the right.
Zhongyanjian.
Right.
Why? Sure. Where?
It's because of the shape. It's like super triangular.
And this one?
Xiangyang.
God, you guys really recognize them like faces.
There's not very many high mountains that have highways next to them.
Right, okay, wow. So that's a nice tell, right?
Okay. Being in the mountains is so good. It's such a relaxed feeling, and Taiwan is a treasure island.
Really?
From the sea to the peak of the mountains.
All 285 of them.
Yes, so guys, if you're watching, come to Taiwan, bring your gear, or buy them in Taiwan.
Right. If you like mountains, we got them.
Yes, and we got friends, we got professionals. Yeah, so come to Taiwan, we'll see you up in the mountains. Wow, Taiwan, see you next time.
See ya.
Bye-bye, thanks guys.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you.